Hello, friends. This is Dave Hurwitz, executive editor at ClassicsToday.com, here to talk to you about, yes, the Arthur Rodzinski edition. This is his New York Philharmonic Complete Columbia albums, mostly recorded between 1945, 1946, 47, in that area. And boy, have they come up sounding good. I was really impressed. They're mono, obviously, and it's, mid-1940s, but they are crisp and clear and beautifully equalized, and there's nothing that comes between you and the music. You can listen to it, decide whether you like the performances or not, without having to make undue allowances for the sound. And I noticed, by the way, that somebody stuck a comment on the comments page that I think I deleted. It said something like, oh, it sounds horrible. Sounds like it was recorded in a bathroom or a bathtub or a bath something, a bath salt, a bath mat. I don't know. Nonsense. Absolute nonsense. It sounds terrific for its period. You have to know what to expect from a 1940s recording. But the dynamic range is there. The clarity is there. I mean, yeah, the bass isn't there so much. And the New York Philharmonic had yet to acquire a tam-tam. Toscanini had a tam-tam. He made sure he had a tam-tam. But even so, I mean, the playing is superb. And Rodzinski was a very interesting conductor in a lot of ways because as an interpreter, well, let's put it this way. You cannot talk about Arthur Rodzinski without mentioning the fact that he always showed up with a loaded pistol in his pocket. He was a little crazy. He was paranoid. He had religious mania. He was a nut job. But you would think that somebody who was that personally eccentric would be a conductor of great willfulness and impetuosity, but he wasn't. He was more of a Toscanini Zell type, that is, a disciplinarian, a conductor who was often very exciting. I mean, he was a quick conductor, fast. He liked zippy tempos for the most part. And when he erred, it was usually on the side of speed. But his interpretations were not willful. He didn't reorchestrate things a la Stokowski. He didn't pull the tempi all over the place, although he inflected, sometimes he inflected heavily in the style of his period, of his epoch and his colleagues. And it's wonderful. I mean, the performances have plenty of personality and character, but they're not eccentric. And that really is a sort of general statement that I would make to preface this 16 CD box. Now, some of the stuff, because I know you're going to ask, because you guys know everything better than I do, some of the stuff in here, obviously New York Philharmonic stuff, is available in the Scribendum Rodzinski box, which contains, like, what, 20 CDs? 19 CDs, pardon me. But most of this is other things. It's not mostly New York Philharmonic stuff. And where there is a direct comparison between New York Phil and this thing here, I can say without any question that the Sony reissue is superior. It's been carefully remastered, for example, in the Rachmaninoff Second Symphony. You can hear it right away. So do not worry if you duplicate. This is the better set sonically. And otherwise, there's not so much that they have in common that makes duplication, you know, ridiculous if you're a Rodzinski fan. So let's go through all 16 discs, as is our wont. I would also point out that Jed Distler wrote an excellent review of this set for Classics Today Insiders with some sound clips. So if you are a Classics Today Insider, do check that out and see how we compare to one another. Disc one. I have my magnifying glass. I finally, 670 videos, and I finally remembered to bring this thing so I can actually read. I can turn that on. See, isn't that cool? All right, Brahms First is CD1, and it's one hell of a Brahms First. You see, it just goes to show you, you have to listen. You can't prejudge anything. I thought, okay, I'm going to put this thing on. It's going to sound sort of grotty and dim, and it just leapt out of the speakers. I mean, that opening introduction with the pounding timpani, boom, boom, bar, it's like Klemperer-like, but the rest of the performance is not. It is not that granitic. It is actually fleeter and more flowing, and it has a very, very fine finale. The whole thing is really, really cogent and beautiful. I can't think of from this period, the mid-1940s, a Brahms one that really sounded this good and probably was played this well. It's absolutely terrific. It's a very good start. Very good start. So, CD2, you get pictures at an exhibition, and the Hopak from Sorochinsky Fair. Now, that's a very short playing time. And it's even shorter playing time because it's a very fast pictures at an exhibition. I mean, the old castle just flies along. The catacombs are not very catacomby. And the hut on Fowl's Legs and Great Gate of Kiev are really ridiculously quick. I mean, just unacceptably quick, especially the Great Gate of Kiev. You know, where the very end is, you know, da, dum, da, dum, da, dum, da, crash. That's the end. It's really not good as a representation. There's no grandeur as a representation of the music, and the playing is quite splendid. There are characterful moments. You know, the portrait of the two Jews is really nicely done. There are a bunch of lovely pieces in and about, but no, he remade pictures in an exhibition, I believe. I think there's one on this. Oh, pardon me. I think there's one in this Scribendum set. Let me put that back. There we go. And let me see here. I think there is, with my little magnifying glassy thing here. Yes, there is, of course. And it's much better. Yeah, definitely, definitely better. But like a lot of conductors in this period, sometimes they just got to be too fast and they didn't really care whether the orchestra could keep up or not. But the fun thing about these performances is that the orchestra does keep up. And that's fun to hear, even when you disagree with the interpretation. So, disc 3, Prokofiev Fifth. Very quick and very exciting, even without the tam-tam at the end of the first movement and in the climax of the slow movement. This is a dazzling Prokofiev Fifth. It really smokes. And, you know, it's one of those indications of how, you know, tempo may have changed since this period, because most performances of the symphony are considerably slower. But these guys, and Zell was another one who was a Prokofiev Fifth specialist, they played it very quickly by our standards, and it's very interesting to hear. This is really something you should listen to if you love Prokofiev's Fifth. It's a wonderful performance. Tchaikovsky, the Nutcracker Suite, fun, some interesting things. The overture is somewhat deliberate. Some of the other dances have more than their usual share of character, which is lovely. And the Mozartiana Suite number 4. Jed thought this performance was a little brusque and a little driven. I actually like it that way. I think it emphasizes the music's, you know, classical brittleness in a way that I find very, very appealing. You may disagree, but it was a rare work at the time that this was recorded, which was, let me see, when was this done? 46, 45 and 46, basically. I mean, it was a real rarity, and it's great to have. It really is. Okay, Enescu, Romanian Rhapsody, number 1. Very nice performance of a piece. Almost everybody does well. And let's see, Liszt, Mephisto Waltz, number 1. And it's also a lot of fun, an insanely fast performance of the Wolf Ferrari Overture to the Secret of Susanna. I mean, boy, oh boy, is this a scorcher. You know, that's an opera buffa, and Susanna's secret is that she smokes. But because she's hiding it, her husband thinks she has a lover. You know, it's a little one-hour-long opera buffa. It's delightful. And it has this three-minute overture, which is 2.5 minutes in this performance, and it just flies by. My God, they're hanging on for dear life. It's fun to listen to. It's not right. It's not really good, but, you know, for that reason. But, boy, to hear it once is... It's entertaining. Entertaining. Ah, okay. Tchaikovsky, Symphony No. 6, The Pathétique. Another work that Rudzinski re-recorded better. This is not a bad pathétique. It's okay. It's just not particularly characterful. And you would think, again, that there's a work where he could, like, go crazy as a romantic, paranoid, schizoid, maniacal character. But it isn't. It's a very straightforward, almost dispassionate interpretation, and he did better. He did better later. But again, you can hear everything. It's clear. There's no issue with listening to it. It's enjoyable enough to listen to. Brahms, Symphony No. 2 on CD6. This is beautiful, too. I got to say something about the Brahms people. Everyone does Brahms. But, you know, at the end of the Second Symphony, at the coda. You know, with its dum ba da 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 dum da 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 da, it seems to speed up. It doesn't really speed up. I mean, Brahms is Brahms. He's not going to write, you know, a cello rondo molto anywhere, but it's supposed to sound like it's speeding up. And one of the great secrets of conducting this music is understanding how to push the tempo without really going that much faster. It's a function of rhythm, and it's a function of timing and where you put the pressure on it to make it sound like the energy is increasing, even though the actual amount of acceleration is quite small. This is something that conductors of this day knew how to do. They just knew it. Some of them really sped up. I mean, Walter did in his New York Philharmonic recording, which is like crazy exciting, and Jochum did, and you know, so there were some who did, but there were also some who, even when they didn't, knew how to sound like they did, and that's something today's conductors never seem to be able to do. They just beat time, you know, and it's just, oh, it's so irritating. Yeah, you can have a little freedom, have a little fun with it, give it an extra jolt. You know, you don't have to be vulgar about it. You don't have to be mattered, as Rudzinski is not. He's excellent. So, there you go. CD 7, Saint-Saëns, Piano Concerto No. 4 with Robert Cazadesus. It's a very good performance, but Cazadesus did the same piece in very good stereo with Bernstein with the same orchestra, and it's arguably better. Jed thought so. I never disagree with Jed about these things. He's right. It was better. And then there's the coupling, which was the Satie de Trois Morceaux en Forme de Poire with Gabi et Robert Cazadesus. Very, very nice. Then we have a really cool American music disc, Morton Gould's Spirituals for Orchestra, an absolutely first-rate performance, and this was its premiere, a terrific work, a very good Copland Lincoln portrait, if you can stand the narration. The narrator is Kenneth Spencer, who does a really good job with it. And finally, Rhapsody in Blue. No, it was not Rhapsody in Blue. It's An American in Paris. It's the other one, the other side of the Rhapsody in Blue record. Yes, An American in Paris, an exciting performance. It's about 16 minutes long, which is the same time as Arthur Fiedler takes with it. And, you know, Rudzinski, it just goes to show you don't have to be American to play this music really well, even though the orchestra was. But, I mean, he was very much in charge, and it's a very convincing and idiomatic An American in Paris. Then we have, let's see, CD 9. I'm not missing anything, am I? I want to make sure, because last time I skipped a page with the Previn box, and you all almost killed me. I mean, oh, my God. You'd think I'd murdered my firstborn or something. Anyway, yeah, no, we're okay. CD 9, Bizet, Symphony in C. A very, very shapely performance with an exciting finale. Nothing not to love. Carmen Entr'acte 3. That's the flute and harp one. Yeah, it's very, very pretty. And then we've got Mio conducting his own Suite Française, which is a wonderful novelty. And Ibert's Escale, with an absolutely sizzling, more cuisine analogies, a sizzling performance of Valencia, or Valentia, however you want to pronounce it. Wow, it really rocks. And it's just tremendous fun. Then we get two discs of Wagner, the complete Act 3 of Die Walküre, featuring, oh my gosh, who is it featuring? Oh, they're so famous, I don't remember them. No, seriously. It's Helen Traubel, who's wonderful. I mean, she's just one of the great Wagnerian sopranos of her day, and she sounds absolutely terrific. And let's see, oh, Herbert Janssen, baritone, who is actually really kind of light-voiced for Wotan. He sings with great attention to the text, but I find him kind of lightweight. And the tenor, there's a tenor in here somewhere, and there's a, let's see, there's another soprano, a Sieglinde and Ortlinde in Act 3, and then a bunch of screaming women doing the Valkyries, and that's that. There's a tenor in the next disc, we'll get to him. You also get, along with Act 3 of Die Walküre, you get the Siegfried Idyll, and it's a perfectly normal Siegfried Idyll, and I really can't stand the Siegfried Idyll, so I don't really care, but it's fine. I mean, it sounds like the Siegfried Idyll. They all sound like the Siegfried Idyll. You ever noticed that? there's not really much you can do with it except slow it down or speed it up a lot. And, you know, anyway, then we get the love duet from Act One of Die Walküre, and the duettists are, once again, Helen Traubel is Sieglinde, Isolde, and Elsa in this bunch of excerpts, which tells you which operas you're getting excerpts from. And the tenor is Emery Darcy, who is Sigmund and Lohengrin, and he tries. That's all I could tell you. He, again, he's strained at the top. He's not a Heldon tenor. He just ain't. You know, he's making an effort, and then Traubel comes in and just sort of blows him into the back wings. It's kind of fun. But the playing is really good. The performances are quite exciting, and Wagner fans will need no recommendation from me to go and get that wonderful, 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 wonderful example of Helen Traubel's art, which is really what this is all about. Next, two Twilight concerts. These are with the Columbia Symphony, I believe, which in those days was like pieces of the New York Philharmonic. It was sometimes Philadelphia, sometimes New York, sometimes, you know, whatever orchestra happened to be handy. Los Angeles, if they were on the West Coast and Bruno Walter was conducting them, it was all called the Columbia Symphony. But the first Twilight concert you get, let's see, you ready? Here we go. The William Tell Overture, Midsummer Night's Dream Scherzo, Rachmaninoff's Second Piano Concerto First Movement with Leonard Panario, Tchaikovsky's Serenade for Strings, The Waltz, just The Waltz, wait a minute, let me turn the page here, more Tchaikovsky, None But the Lonely Heart, sung by Martha Lipton. Remember Martha Lipton? She's the alto soloist of the Bernstein Mahler III, the first one. L'Arlésienne Farandole, the Clair de Lune of Debussy, Liszt's Hungarian Rhapsody Number 2. And it's all just played, it's all fun. You know, you do what they intended you to do. You drop the needle at the beginning and then do whatever else you want to do and come back when it's over. I don't mean you ignore it. What I mean is it just plays and it's all very enjoyable and well-programmed and it has a nice, nice contrast of goodies. And the Twilight Concert 2 gives you Offenbach, Orpheus of the Underworld with a swinging can-can, the middle movement of the Franck D minor. Isn't that interesting? I think that's fascinating. Debussy's Fête from Nocturnes, two movements from the Love for Three Oranges suite, the March, of course, and the Scherzo. And then we get Gershwin, Summertime from Porgy and Bess, sung by Genevieve Rowe, and the Dinicu Hora Staccato, arranged by Heifetz, which I don't know why anyone plays that. I mean, it's cute, it's funny, it's just, wow, okay. Scheherazade, The Young Prince and the Young Princess, that's the third movement. And then to wrap things up, the Russian Sailor's Dance from Glier's The Red Poppy. These are just nice, fun Pops programs, two Pops concerts, and they should be popular. Then on CD14, Sibelius 4. We just did our Sibelius 4 talk. An excellent performance of Sibelius 4, especially the finale, which uses chimes, not glockenspiel. But the point is that Rudzinski shapes the whole thing really, really well, remarkably well. I mean, considering, you know, how unfamiliar the music was in those days, but this is a perfectly idiomatic, wonderful performance. And I enjoyed it. I just enjoyed listening to it. I dropped it and thought, well, I'll sample. I'd had it before. I've heard it several times. But I found myself just listening to the whole thing because it was terrific. It's just terrific. And then we have Rachmaninoff's Second Symphony, the traditional version with cuts. But the interesting thing about that is that, for example, at the end of the first movement, where everyone usually adds a timpani thwomp, Rudzinski does not. He's respectful of the text. He really is. And he gets the orchestra to really play. The scherzo is superbly rhythmic. The finale is really exciting. I mean, I sneakily kind of like the finale with a little cut or two here or there. You know, now it's become, some people even take the exposition repeat in the finale, which I think is just insane. It just seems to go on forever. But it's a beautiful, beautiful performance. I don't even mind cutting the adagio, frankly. Don't tell anyone I told you. but it's really very, very, very fine. And then finally, last but not least, a all on one disc, the Rachmaninoff Second Piano Concerto with Georgi Shandor, which of course is in the Georgi Shandor box. This is a very well integrated, as Jed pointed out also, Rachmaninoff II, with the orchestra and the piano really participating in a symphonic dialogue. The nice thing about it is that while the finale is just a tiny bit on the measured side, I don't mean boring side, I just mean measured, tempo-wise, the first two movements are very nicely flowing. And there's a lot of a very effective give and take between the piano and the orchestra, and I like the performance. It's not a hot and heavy, sweaty kind of performance. It's a little bit more reserved, but none the worse for wear. And so, that, my friends, is the Rudzinski edition. And I gotta say, I'm really happy to have it. He was an estimable conductor. He knew what he was doing. Even where he's kind of like in pictures in an exhibition and a couple other places where he's a little eccentric or he's behaving a little strangely, you know, you forgive him. The ratio of hits to misses is very, very, very impressive, because mostly these are excellent performances for their period. Particularly, he had the New York Philharmonic playing extremely well. And you get to hear the Philharmonic in an era where it was sort of between, remember, between Toscanini left, then Barbaroli showed up, and then they had some, you know, temporary people, and Bruno Walter was there, and finally Metropolis showed up, but Sony has not given Metropolis his due yet, and they need to. And then Bernstein showed up. So there's this sort of big period where we need to document what was going on at the Philharmonic. And this is a wonderful start, a wonderful beginning. And it shows us that the New York Philharmonic was and remained a great orchestra throughout this period. I was delighted to hear these performances, and you will be too. So keep on listening, friends. Thank you for joining me. Take care.